Hi everyone, I'm back with a new video and more exercises for you to play around with filters and body diagrams. I'm Gio, an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona, and my expertise is in wireless communications, and I also give theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems. So if you want to learn the fundamentals of signals and systems rather quickly, this is the right channel for you. So let's get started with filters and body diagrams. The first exercise for today considers an LTI system, which is basically given by a differential equation that relates input and output. Okay, so it's the derivative of y of t and dt plus 2y of t equals x of t, where obviously x of t is the input and y of t is the output. The first question is about determining the frequency response of the system. So let's go on with that. To start with, we can take the Fourier transform of the left and right hand side of the equation that describes the system. And this is a simple one because we know that the derivative in the time domain, a differentiation, corresponds to a product by j omega in the frequency domain. So the Fourier transform of the derivative of y is given by j omega y of j omega, where y of j omega is the Fourier transform of y of t. And then if we keep going, simply plus 2y of j omega equals x of j omega, right? Then the frequency response h of j omega is given, as we know, by the ratio between the output and the input in the Fourier domain. So this is very simply calculated, and what we obtain is 1 over 2 plus j omega, so first order term. Let me take note of that so we can keep going. So now what we need to do is to sketch the diagram of the magnitude of the frequency response. So this is what it is. It's the magnitude of that complex function. And we know that the magnitude of a complex number can be obtained as the square root of the sum between the square real part and the square imaginary part. This is what I'm doing here. So the magnitude is simply 1 over square root of 4 plus omega square. So in a decibel scale, so in logarithmic scale, if I calculate 20 log 10 of this quantity, I can further simplify it, okay, and I come up with minus 10 log 10 of 4 plus omega square. So here I can simply approximate the diagram by considering two cases. The first case, which is when omega is much smaller than 2, then in that case the term 4 inside the brackets prevails, and I can approximate this with minus 10 log 10 of 4. And in the other case, when omega is much larger than 2, well, omega squared prevails over 4, so I can approximate that with minus 20 log 10 of omega, right? So let's just draw this. Let's recall that minus 10 log 10 of 4 is roughly minus 6 dBs. So I have a switch, a cutoff point at omega equal 2. So to the left of that, the behavior is the one that I found, and it's basically a straight line because it's constant, okay, and it's about minus 6 dB. But then after that, there's a term that kicks in, a first order term that provides a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. Okay, so then my diagram goes down by 20 dB for every 10x increment of the variable omega. Okay, so it goes down to minus 26 when omega is 20, minus 46 when omega is 200, and so on and so forth, right? So now let's go on with part C. Now we're given an input, x of t, which is e to minus t u of t, and we need to determine the output, right? So the output y of t can be obtained as the anti-transform of y of j omega, okay? So I can simply calculate the output in the frequency domain and then calculate the anti-transform, okay? So the output in the frequency domain is given by the product between x of j omega and h of j omega, and then I need to do the anti-transform. Right, so what is x of j omega? First of all, we need to calculate the Fourier transform of the input, which is a simple right-sided exponential that we've seen many times in previous classes. If you do the calculations, you probably already recall what the result is. It's 1 over 1 plus j omega. So let me take note of that. So now we know h and x, and we know the product. We need to calculate the anti-transform of the product, right? How to do that? Well, remember that if I can write this Fourier transform as the sum of different terms, then I can exploit the linearity property to calculate simpler anti-transform terms and then sum them up, right? So what I mean is that I should be able to do a partial fraction expansion as the one that you see at the center left of this slide, where there's two coefficients that needs to be determined, A and B. Okay, so I write it all as the anti-transform of A over 1 plus j omega plus B over 2 plus j omega. So I further developed this, okay, by mixing together the denominator. So at the denominator, I have again the product 1 plus j omega times 2 plus j omega. And at the numerator, I have all the cross terms that I calculated, given by A that multiplies 2 plus j omega and B that multiplies 1 plus j omega. Okay, so this is what I obtain. Now, to determine the coefficients A and B, I need to make sure that the numerator is equal to 1, which is what I started with before. So the numerator is going to be equal to 1 only if the term in omega is 0. So j omega times a plus b has to be 0. And the term that has no omega has to be 1. Okay, so 2a plus b has to be equal to 1. So if I solve this very simple system of equations, then I'll be given a and b that satisfy my equality. So let's do that. I get from the second equation that a is equal to minus b, which I can replace in the one on top, obtaining that 2a minus a is equal to 1, and therefore a is equal to 1, and as a result b is equal to minus 1. So let me replace these values in place of a and b, and that's it. So now I can continue, because now I have the anti-transform of a sum. Because of linearity, I can anti-transform the terms one by one and sum the result. So if I do that, I know that the first term will give me e to minus t u of t, and the second term will give me minus e to minus 2t u of t. They're both right-sided exponentials. So I have calculated my output y of t. Let me take note of that again, because now I just would like to verify and double check that this is correct. So since I have the equation, the differential equation that regulates the behavior of the system, let me check if this y of t and the x of t that I was given do satisfy the equation, just as a sanity check. So what I need to do is calculate the derivative of y of t, and then sum twice y of t, and then see if this is equal to x of t. So here's what I'm doing by doing all these calculations. So the derivative is the derivative of a product, which I decomposed as derivative of the first term times the second term plus first term times the derivative of the second term. So if we keep going with the calculations, we have several exponential terms that we can group up, okay? They all multiply the function e of t. And then we have a term which multiplies a delta. So again, we recall the sampling property of the delta. We evaluate that term at t equals 0, because the delta is at time 0. And we obtain basically 1 minus 1. So this will disappear, and so some other terms. So in the end, if you see after these simplifications, you get e to minus t u of t, and that's exactly the x of t that we were given at the beginning. So the sanity check worked. Cool. Now let's move on to the next exercise. Here we need to sketch the diagrams for the magnitude of certain frequency responses of certain systems. We're given three systems, so let's start with the first one, which is part A. Okay, so in this case, the frequency response is j omega plus a. So to obtain the diagram, I need to calculate 20 log 10, the magnitude of that. Okay, so again, it's a complex function. I write the magnitude as the square root of omega square plus a square. And by doing some simple calculations, well, the expression I have is 10 log 10 omega square plus a square. Now, again, I can approximate this by finding two different regimes. For example, when omega is much larger than a, then it prevails. And I can approximate my function with 10 log 10 omega square or 20 log 10 omega, which is the same. And in the other case, when omega is much smaller, well, then I simply have 20 log 10 of a, right? So if I plot this, what I have is that I have a cutoff at omega equal a. To the left of that, so for smaller values of omega, the value is 20 log a. And then after that, I'll have a term that grows by 20 dB per decade. So here's what it does. It grows by 20 dB when I jump from frequency A to frequency 10A, and by another 20 dB is when I jump to frequency 100A. So it's 20 dB per decade growing, right? Now let's move to part B. Okay, so in part B I have something a little bit more involved, because my h of j omega is the product of several things. There's a fraction there and there's a factor 10. So a simpler way to do this is, well, first of all, let's write the magnitude of that expression. Okay, I do it separately for numerator and denominator, and this is what I obtain. And now, because of the properties of the logarithms, well, I know that the logarithm of this product can be broken down into the sum of three logarithms, obviously. So the first one is 20 log 10 of 10, which is very easy, as we will see. The second one is 20 log 10 of the square root of omega squared plus 0.01. And the third one is 20 log 10 of 1 over the square root of omega squared plus 100. So these terms are all different. They all have different behaviors. I need to study their behavior separately. Well, that's the easiest thing to do at least. And then sum up everything I obtain. So let's label them as 1, 2, and 3. So the first term is very simple. It gives me 20 dB constant, okay? The second term depends on omega, so I will have a certain trend. So if I study again, I can find two regimes when omega is larger than 0.1 and smaller than 0.1, okay? And we see that there's a constant behavior for smaller frequencies, minus 20 dB. And for larger frequencies, there is a growing behavior by 20 dB per decade, if I calculate that, right? What about number three? So to conclude, number three will be negative, because you see that the omega is at the denominator. And then again, the cutoff frequency in this case is omega equal to 10. So when omega is much larger, omega squared prevails over 100. And I can approximate this with minus 20 log 10 omega. So decreasing slope of minus 20 dB per decade and a constant of minus 20 dB elsewhere, right? So if we put all of this together, let's try to draw the different terms. The first term, term number one, as I say, is constant, 20 dB flat. There's no dependency on omega, right? So let's move on to the second one. The second one has a cutoff at 0.1. So for smaller frequencies, it's constant, minus 20. And then it grows by 20 dB per decade, okay? This is drawn in purple. And then the term number three, which I draw in green, has a cutoff at omega equal 10. So it's minus 20 for smaller frequencies, and then it goes down by 20 dB per decade, right? So what I need to do is now to sum up these three terms to obtain the final diagram for h of j omega. So let's do that. So, and here's what I obtain. I have a constant, minus 20, then this grows by 20 dB per decade, okay? And then from omega equal 10 onwards, it's constant again, because there are two terms that compensate each other. One is growing and one is decaying, right? So now I have the third and final part of this exercise, which gives me another h of j omega, and I notice that this is exactly the reciprocal of the one that I just solved, okay? So basically, this new h of j omega in part C is 1 over the h of j omega in part B, right? They are the reciprocal of one another. So because we're operating in the logarithmic scale, let's recall that the logarithm of 1 over a, where a can be anything except for 0, is minus the logarithm of a, right? So that means that when I operate in the logarithmic regime and I try to draw the Bode diagram, the Bode diagram is going to be exactly the opposite. It's going to be mirrored. It's going to be the same with a negative sign before, right? So if this was the Bode diagram that I got in for part B, well, I can simply draw the one for part C by multiplying everything by minus 1. So now I start at plus 20 dB, then I go down by 20 dB per decade, and then it's constant, right? So here it is. So surely you can also calculate that by doing the calculations one by one, and you have to obtain the same result as shown here. Right, so in this video we have kept practicing Bode diagrams and filters through more exercises. I hope this helps you get more familiar with this important topic in signals and systems, and more video exercises on this and other topics are coming up, so subscribe to this channel and you'll be the first one to know when I upload a new video. See you in the next one.